Hey, y'all. Thank y'all so much for joining this week. Tea Time with Tosh. Kyron is off this week. He sends his blessings and wishes. He will be back with us in 2 more weeks. But this episode is great, just like all the other ones. It's controversial. It is something that God placed on my spirit to speak to because he needs to save his people. So you guys are going to fight me in the comments. I'm ready for you. I know the beehive is always on the way. So with no further ado, this week's episode is Yonce and Hov, to be or not to be. That is the question. Ritual shaking vessels exit stage left. Come on now, y'all. So let's get into it. So the reason why, like I said, this God placed this episode in my spirit this week is because there is a lot surrounding the Carters that many people don't know. You all think that they are these wonderful, powerful couples. I used to be one of the ones that thought that way. But God said that there has been a lot of misleading of the flock, and there has been a lot of idolatry passing through his people, and he needs everyone to turn away from the idols because rapture is coming soon. We don't know the hour, second, moment, or when he's coming, but it is coming soon. So he said that I'm placing this responsibility in front of you for you to be able to tell my people to pivot from their idols. So let's get into the episode. Now, I'm going to go ahead and talk about the background, obviously, on how I used to be a huge fan of the Carters. So let's just talk about when I was like, I think I was in my teens, maybe like, what, 14. And I used to think that Jay-Z was the number one artist, top five on my list. I knew all his lyrics, all his songs. I was a tomboy when I was little, so most of the music that I listened to was rap. My cousin Michael and I shared that love for music, so Jay-Z was one of the favorite artists. Now, with Beyonce, I was a fan when she was in Destiny's Child. Many people like to argumentatively say that they became fans when she was just Beyonce solo in 2003. No, my loves. I was following her when she was a part of Destiny's Child, when it was the original group of LaToya, LaTavia, her, and Kelly. And so my love for this artist went back far. So this is not coming from someone that is a Beyonce hater or anyone that is trying to make you all feel like I am jealous in any way. One thing I don't do is I don't put idolatry on anything, and I'm not a jealous-hearted person. I don't see envy. I think all Black women are queens and that we all have space in industries that we operate in to win. So I wanted to start off by saying that before you all try to attack me in the comments. Now, the reason why this has changed since then is obviously because there were a lot of revelations. Now, when God saved me recently back in September of this year, and I start going on a Daniel fast and all that, one thing that he did was he started revealing to me things that I needed to pivot away from. A lot of the times when we are saying that we're Christian in this life, we're lukewarm. Now, what lukewarm simply means is that we rever God, we believe in God, but we have a lot of idolatry to things in the world, and we fraternize with things in the world. Worldly vices like drinking, turning up, cursing, all the things that God is not pleased with. And so we do these things and we think that, oh, if we repent or apologize, then we'll be forgiven. And it doesn't work like that. God gives grace true, and he allows us to be forgiven for many of the things that we do in this life when we don't have knowledge. When you're ignorant to the things that are in the Bible, that's where grace is extended from him, because he knows that you don't know any better. But once you ascend to wisdom and knowledge, that is where grace pivots, and he starts judging you a little bit more harshly than he would someone that doesn't know any better. So when I was saved recently, he started revealing to me the things that I was putting idolatry toward. One of them was Beyonce. Now, I'm not going to say that I had idolatry like some of the people in her beehive that worship and rever her like she's a god. I just liked her music, and I really would spend the money to go to the concerts, and I didn't care. Now, I wasn't spending no rent money on that, but I was going to every concert, and I was supporting her. My sister was as well. We genuinely loved her from the moment she left Destiny's Child and even when she was a part of the group. So that is the backstory on how I had this epiphany that I needed to turn away from Beyonce. One of the first revelations that I had was my boyfriend that I have right now, currently, he is very connected to God. He is a disciple of Christ, and he actually kind of helped mold who I'm becoming now as it is following Christ. And obviously, I took it from there in my own relationship and covenant with God. So he told me, you know, you like Beyonce a lot and you talk about Beyonce a lot, but you do know that God doesn't favor Beyonce. And I was like, what are you talking about? And I was attacking him like I was a part of the beehive now. And he said, here's what I'm going to have you do. And this is what I'm actually going to challenge you all listening to me right now to do. Don't take my word for it. You have to sometimes test the spirit in people. So when someone tells you something, it's not up for you to just take it at face value. You have to go back and take it back to God, just like I did with him. So when he told me that God wasn't pleased with Beyonce, I had to go and pray about it and ask God, if there is something impartial about the connection that I have in this artist, please show me and reveal that to me. So when I did that, I wasn't prepared for what he showed me. Now, I talked about it in a previous episode in like a breezeway kind of comment, but this is the episode that's going to be dedicated to this. So I'm going to give you an account on what I saw. In this revelation, it was a dream that I had, and most dreams that you have are revelations or parables. There was a foresight of Beyonce levitating above an audience, right? It was an audience of a massive crowd. We know what type of people B brings to the audience. So she was levitating over top of them, and she had these eyes that had lasers in them, and her eyes went around the whole crowd, and she started spinning around really fast like a whirlwind. Her hair was just full and blonde, and she had like this Medusa-looking crown on her head, and she was spinning around the crowd with her lasers going everywhere. And when that happened, I was like scared to death. And I woke up like, what does this mean? So I called my friend and I unpacked the revelation with him. He's good at breaking down parables. And he explained to me the levitation above the crowd is almost like a possession. When you see her levitating over the crowd, spinning with these lasers, it's like she's possessing everyone that is in the audience that are revering her or that is there supporting her music. And when she does this, this is mainly her being able to bring souls over to the dark side, to the demonic side, right? And so when she echoes the lyrics, you haters corny with that Illuminati mess, that is almost like a mockery or a play on what people are actually being revealed to by God as what she represents. Her and her husband have been revealed to me in the spiritual realm from God. This is not anything alleged. This is something God dropped in my spirit, that she is a part of the Illuminati occultic. It is something that she revers in the spirit realm. She has sacrificed a lot. And when I say a lot, I even get chills thinking about the revelations of what sacrifices she made to rise to the fame that she has. Now, I'm going to give you a rundown of some of the things that she's done over the years. Both of them have done to raise or to rise to the fame that they now possess at billionaire status. When you are navigating in an industry, the devil will find his vessels that are in the industry, whether it's producers, whether it is some type of person that brings you to the producer as a handler or whatever the case may be. Jay-Z is known as an industry handler, and it is a lot of rhetoric out there about it. This episode is probably one of the first ones you'll see where I have a ton of sources to cite so that you can go back and do your own research and follow some of the path that I took to bring you this information today. So when you talk about handlers, a lot of the times these handlers will bring souls to the table and will offer them, just like Lucifer does in the Bible, where he tried to do with Jesus when Jesus was in the wilderness. He offers them worldly things, riches, all the ownership of things, beauty, all the things that the world idolizes. He offers that for the exchange of your soul. And when you exchange your soul, the expectation is that whatever is asked of you in those different moments that you have to go back to the table with the devil is that you would fulfill those things. And I know this sounds like a lot for the average person to listen to, but you have to understand, just like the world is built in the physical realm, the spiritual realm is actually far greater than what we see in the spirit and the physical. So please understand that I'm not saying these comments lightly. Like I said, I'm not a hater or anything. These are real revelations that God brought forth to me. So I'm not going to use alleged a lot in this episode, except for when I'm using different occurrences, because a lot of these things came directly from God. God is not pleased with a lot of the idolization that is happening and passing through the people that are in this world right now. There's a huge spiritual warfare that is going on. Thank you, Holy Spirit, where the devil is trying to gain as many souls, which is why a lot of celebrities and artists are no longer hiding in plain sight, making songs up and putting little blurbs in the songs, and we're singing them and we're not realizing what is being said. They're not doing that anymore. Now they're playing exactly in your face, and these things are very blatant. All of the demonic things that they're doing, the colors that they're wearing, reds, blacks, all the things that they're doing, all the symbolism and the imagery, it's starting to be very bold because there's no more time to hide these things in plain sight. It has to be a very bold account of taking souls, hence the reason for Astro World with Travis Scott and all of the different things that he was doing during that concert where people lost their lives and people were sacrificed at these at this concert because of all the demonic things that were happening. The very same thing happened with Renaissance. Now, I'm going to give you all an example, but before I get into that, I'm going to just define to you what idolization is. Idolization or idolatry is it consists of divinizing what is not God. So let's just say, for example, your child can be an idol. If you rever your child more than you praise and worship God or seek God, that's an idol. If you drink more than you seek God, that's an idol. If you shop more and you like labels, that is an idol. Anything that you place beyond your relationship with how you seek God on a day-to-day basis is idolatry, and God is displeased with it. He's watching everyone that is idolizing things on this earth, especially Beyonce's followers. So now we're going to get into the meat and potatoes of this conversation. Now, what I wanted to talk about is mainly where she first started making music on her own. Now, obviously, when she first started making her music in 2003, when she went solo, Jay-Z and her did the collaboration of Crazy in Love. Crazy in Love took the audience by storm, and it was her stamp of and her imprint in the industry of what we now know as Beyonce, the Queen. And that's not where she obviously that's not where she is now. She's far beyond that. But when she first started out, she was building a brand. And when she first started doing collaboration with Jay-Z, everyone was interested in it. It was like they were this hot new young couple, even though Jay-Z was technically what we would consider now young. He was 30-something. Beyonce was just a tender age of 18, 19 when they first started dating in 2001. So when you think of what that truly looks like, think of it now in life. When you have an 18-year-old young lady dating a 30-something-year-old young man, the first thing that you can think of is that there's going to be some form of manipulation, not across the board for everyone, but most of the times that's the case. Most young women that are that young don't have a lot of wisdom. They have not passed through a lot of experiences, so they're easily controlled and manipulated, right? And so when they started dating back then, it was like prime rib on a platter. She was easily able to be groomed. She was easily open and a vessel ready to take the industry by storm because now she's the solo artist. So she's trying to find her way in the industry. So Jay-Z saw that as a prime opportunity. Now I'm going to pivot from Beyonce for a second just to focus on Jay-Z. We do know, and I don't know if many of you know about Jay-Z's past, but Jay-Z has had many different experiences where he has had moments where he has stabbed someone or stabbed him multiple times, and that is his past. He has sold drugs. He has talked about this in a lot of his albums. He has done so many different things that he's openly discussed, but the thing that I want to really focus on is this Jehovah, and I don't rever that word or that name that he calls himself, but I've been using that because I wanted to pivot to this conversation. If you follow the Bible, you know that Jesus is revered as Jehovah. Jehovah Jireh. And for that being the case, when you look at Jay-Z calling himself Jehovah, it's making a mockery. It's blaspheming Jesus Christ. God is not pleased with that because so many people are echoing these words, this word, this name that he has deemed and coined himself. And in many of his albums and his music, he talks about openly how he revers himself as a god. And he even said in an interview before, you can check out the interview, I'll make sure that I link it below if you want to check it out yourself, where he actually told one of the interviewers that when he first started calling himself Jehovah and everything like that, he didn't think about anything that was connected to the Bible because he said he never picked up the Bible before. But what you have to understand, my loves, is that Lucifer is a fallen angel. He is the angel of music. He was the angel of music, and he was one of God's high priest angels. He fell from the acknowledgement that God gave him because he was trying to become God. He wanted to contend with God. And we know that whenever you try to contend with God, God will put you back in your place. And as we all know, hell is where he resides. And so because of this, the artists that are singing in this industry and all these things, they don't have to open up the Bible because Lucifer gives them the content. He drops it in their spirit. Once you sell your soul in the industry to the devil for fame, he will give you supplication so that you can keep doing the works of him. And so in this case, Jay-Z was given a lot of content about what is in the Bible. He's blasphemed it. He's made scriptures in reverse and twisted them up. He has done so many different things that now he's doing these things in plain sight. I'm going to fast forward really quick to the most recent Grammys. I personally didn't like his speech for the Grammys. And the reason why is because I felt like it was almost like a more dressed up version of what Kanye did years ago. And him and Beyonce were mortified by Kanye's boldness and his truth in what he felt she should have got the award over Taylor Swift. But one thing I can say about Kanye is at least he stands 10 toes down on what he says. Is no matter how crazy people paint him out to be, he's a bold person that stands in how he feels. And he really doesn't care too much about what people think. With Jay-Z, I felt like this was a power move because now you're being awarded this Dr. Dre award. And now that you're getting this award, you feel like you can flex and kind of showboat a little bit. And so you're extending this conversation about how she has never been given the award of album of the year. And to me, how dare you even say that? Because she has tons of Grammys. Yes, she's worked hard, but I'm going to let you all know later on in this episode a lot of alleged things that she's done to plagiarize a lot of the songs she stamped her name on being producer in, and a lot of the things that she stamped on creative direction, how she's sampling and stealing these things from other artists. So we'll pivot over to that, but I'm going to just talk about the specific Grammys performance where he had a whole audience set up on stage with some of the others that were on there. I think DJ Khaled was on there as well. They were dressed in all black, like an omen, and they were revering the Last Supper. Now, for those of you that don't know what that looks like, it was just before Jesus was crucified, where he had the supper with his disciples, and they revered the wine as the body, as the blood, and the body of Christ was the bread, and that was a symbolization. Well, Jay-Z wanted to rever himself because, like I told you, he calls himself Jehovah, and he mocked Jesus and doing this Last Supper in all black. And this is what I mean when I say these artists are no longer hiding in plain sight anymore. They're putting these things right in front of your face because they spent so many years grooming their audiences and their fans to believe that they really are good people and that there's always a if-then situation that you can bring to the table with the things that they do. And maybe it's not what they really mean. And maybe that's not what it is. They're no longer focusing on doing that. They've groomed their fans enough where the fans are going to fight for them and speak up for the mockeries that they make of Jesus Christ and God. And like I said, God is not favored by any of those things. So I'm going to pivot back over to just getting the background on some of the things that passed through the industry as it relates to Jay-Z. We all know that Jay-Z used to date Foxy Brown. Well, more accounts, and I have the information linked below, where Foxy Brown has had very bold conversations and interviews where she's basically talking about how her and Jay-Z had this relationship when she was 15. He was definitely well over 20, and he groomed her. He helped her get, you know, her fame in the industry. He was like her handler of sorts, and they had this ongoing relationship. But the reason why Jay-Z wanted to pivot away from his relationship with Foxy, obviously, is he's been painted out to be a womanizer, and that's what he is. He passes through the industry as a womanizer. But on top of that, he was no longer in cahoots with Foxy Brown because she was said to run her mouth too much, and it was just too much of chaos when dealing with her. She was a fighter and she was very aggressive. So those of you that don't know, you can go back and look at Foxy's past. She was a firework, and Jay-Z wanted to part ways with that. So that was one of the reasons why they broke up, but she still never really badmouthed him to the degree that she probably could have. And then you want to pivot over to, after that, Dame Dash and Aaliyah's relationship. One of those things that I looked at when I was looking at the whole content that I researched about Aaliyah and Dame. Dame was fine as I don't know what back in the day. I'm going to just make that little excerpt because I didn't even know that he was that handsome. I really didn't pay much attention to Dame back in the day because I told you Jay-Z was my guy. And so when I looked at Dame, I was like, I see why Aaliyah chose Dame over Jay-Z. He was more charismatic and he was handsome. And so I think because, in fact, I'm 100% sure that when a man that thinks highly of himself sees another man take a woman that they're interested in, it's like an ego killer. It's like a buzzkill. And so with that being said, Jay-Z felt some kind of way toward Dame because Aaliyah chose Dame. And so all of the things that we know that we watched happen with Rockefeller and the way that everything shifted with Jay-Z and Dame's relationship and how he kind of just completely snaked him and cut him out the deal and took the whole label to himself. It was like a snake move. And for me, I always say you can test the fruit in people by the way that they move. The content of their character tells you a lot about a person. And while I was not old enough to understand how that was snake-like behavior, now that I'm older and I understand it very well, Anybody that can do something like that to a friend is going to be able to do anything to anybody. And 50 Cent said it so eloquently in one of the interviews where he was asked to give his concept on some of the artists in the industry. And when it got to Jay-Z, he said, what's a word that you would use to describe Jay-Z? And 50 Cent said it so eloquently. He said he a businessman. And that's exactly what that looks like. When somebody is a businessman, what you have to understand is they will do anything by any means necessary to gain whatever clout, whatever fame, whatever financial gain or resources that they need to build an empire. So when you think of that and the way that he snaked Dame Dash, it was all because he was building this empire. And because Aaliyah did not want to be the next Mrs. Jehovah in his own eyes, he felt like she also was collateral damage. So this is alleged because there are no documents pointing toward this being factual, but there are many people in the industry that have said it, Mary J. Blige being one of them, stating that Aaliyah was a spiritual sacrifice. A spiritual sacrifice, for those of you that don't know, it means that anything in the spirit realm that can be handed over in the form of death, in the form of murder, in the form of blackballing someone's career, or even just in the form of doing some sort of witchcraft, which is what I'll talk about later on in this episode, all of those things look like a spiritual sacrifice. In this case, Aaliyah's spiritual sacrifice was when she was put on a plane, drugged. She was not conscious. She had told Dame earlier, before she did Rock the Boat, that she didn't even want to get on the plane. She was scared. Dame told her not to do it. But obviously, when you're a successful artist that is very hardworking like Aaliyah, you're going to do what you got to do. And so she went and did the shoot, and then she was going to come back that same day. Well, when Aaliyah was getting on board to the craft, number one, the aircraft was full of luggage. It was too heavy. It was not enough weight. It was too much weight, should I say, on this aircraft. And the guy that was flying the aircraft was drug induced. So because you put these factors together, you tell me what type of celebrity at the status that Aaliyah was at would ever be put in a situation like that and there not be some other type of ramifications in place to combat this type of thing. Why would they put her on a cargo flight back to where she's going if that was not a spiritual sacrifice? And a lot of people have speculated, and there has been a lot of alleged claims that Diddy and Jay-Z both used Aaliyah as a sacrifice so that Beyonce could rise to fame. And I'm going to be very honest with you. God revealed to me in the spiritual realm through revelation that that story is true. But I'm going to say alleged because there's no evidence as far as in the physical realm that that's what happened. But mark my words, you will hear more about this story later on because many people will start reporting on it. So you just heard it here first. So the next thing that I want to talk about is one of the things, one of the other young ladies that he was working with in the industry named Tierra Marie. I don't know if you all know Tierra Marie, but Tierra Marie was one of the up and coming fly artists. She had all the look, all the vibes, all the energy, and she was one of the next would have been Beyonce's, if you will. But what happened is, allegedly, there was a meeting where Tierra Marie was performing and Rihanna was the next up on the docket as far as one of Jay-Z's new artists. Well, Beyonce was talking to one of the producers and threw a bug out there that girl Rihanna, she's dope. You need to check her out. And when that bug was put in the ear of the producer, he said that he pivoted away from Tierra Marie after he had already expounded so many resources and financial gain in building Tierra Marie up to the point that she was, that her career was snubbed from her and that Rihanna was put in place. And the reason why it was alleged that Beyonce did that was because Jay-Z was sleeping with Tierra Marie. Now, this is alleged, but this is one of the pieces of information that I received during my research as to why Beyonce did what she did and why Tierra Marie later became a laughingstock. Ray J became her handler on Love and Hip Hop. You know, she had passed through some things with Diddy. And there is just so many different alleged things that have happened to this poor young woman that in the recent Jane Doe lawsuit, according to a lot of records, because a person is remaining unnamed, Tierra Marie is the Jane Doe that filed a lawsuit against Diddy because of some of the things that happened to her in that industry. My loves, I'm trying to tell y'all, when I bring these episodes to you and I talk to you about this information, I don't do it from a space of me making things up. I spend hours researching information so that I'm bringing things to you that can be verified or that can be researched on your own from other reporters that are giving information. But my information that I'm bringing to you is not just research in the physical realm. It's also revelations that God sent to me. So you're getting two different perspectives when I come to you about these kinds of things. I know it's heavy to hear. I know many of you are going to be like, oh, she's just a hater. I don't want to hear nothing about it. You have your choice. You pick up your cross and you decide which way you're going to go. But by the end of this episode, I bet you, I almost challenge you that you will be moved to start doing research on the things that I'm reporting, because these things aren't light. And I would never come on here and to tarnish another Black woman's character unless there is something within her character that is misleading God's people. And my journey in this ministry is to make sure I'm bringing people closer to Jesus, not further away from them. That's my responsibility. So we're going to get back into the meat and potatoes. I just felt like that was very important to interject. Now, one of the things that I wanted to also talk about after Tierra Marie was the plagiarizing piece of Beyonce's career. Now, I don't know if you all know about the Carrie Hilson situation, where this is just going to pivot a little bit back from the plagiarizing accusation and just talk about how Carrie Hilson's career was said to be blackballed by Jay-Z and Beyonce collectively. Now, the reason why they said that her career was blackballed is because in her song Turning Me On, she threw shade, saying something along the lines that Beyonce could sing, but she needed to move on to the left and go have some kids or something like that. And they said that she was throwing shade because of some of the other, I guess, business aspects or affairs that she might have had with Beyonce, where she felt snubbed or she felt like something wasn't done with integrity. So this was her way of shading her because of some of those other things. Do your research to figure it out and research more. But that's one of the reasons why Carrie Hilson's career was said to be blackballed by the Carters. Now, the next thing that I'm going to pivot over to is Ne-Yo writing Irreplaceable on the B-Day album. That was a big song. It was a hot song. We love that song. But Jay-Z and Beyonce collectively, when the album was rolled out, did not give credits to Ne-Yo for writing this song. Many songs on that album were said to be written by Beyonce, but a lot of people that were ghostwriting, and even just some people that were songwriters that weren't even ghostwriters, had said that she had said a lot of the songs that they wrote for her, she wrote herself. And so when she started deeming herself as a producer and writer, a lot of people were argumentatively saying that that wasn't a viable title for her because she had so much help in writing a lot of her songs. Did she collab with them? Sure. But to write the entire song, that was said to be false. And a lot of people are coming out more and more now, as of more recent, saying how she doesn't write or didn't write a lot of her music. So when, just so it's pause right here, when you look at these type of accusations that are allegedly coming from people that are in the industry that are actually being paid to write for other artists, and they're saying that she snubbed them and didn't give them credits for their art, it makes you wonder how could anyone feel like she was snubbed the Album of the Year award, or that she wasn't given the accolades out as to how hard she works by the Grammys or whoever else. When God appoints you in this life, if you're doing and operating in your niche or in your craft or within your talent from a place of integrity, it doesn't matter what man walking this earth says. It doesn't matter how they feel. It doesn't matter the shade they throw or the things they speak against you. When God authors the things that you do, you will receive provision for those things. So if she truly was the artist that she promotes herself to be, the artist that we, so many of us, have been misled to believe she is, we would not see places where she's not getting accolades that she should have. Now, argumentatively, the people that are in the Grammys, a lot of them are skewed. A lot of the things that they're doing, we can be honest, are given to Caucasian white America. We're just going to be real. I'm always going to be real on this podcast. This is no offense. This is the reality of what we're passing through in this life. But when you are a solid, sound artist, you will be able to get the honor and the accolades that you rightfully deserve, even if it's not in that moment. At some point, you are going to be blessed because God always blesses his people. That's how he is. The devil, when he gives his people a blessing, it comes with torment. It comes with lack in a lot of ways. It comes with depression. It comes with frustrations, doubt, insecurity, every negative emotion that you can think of. That is how the devil authors the people that sell their souls to him for fame pass through when they're creating their art. So I just wanted to let you know that before you make the statement that she was trumped or wasn't given what she rightfully deserved. If it was hers and she deserved it, God would have made sure she had it. And that's on period. So the next thing that I want to talk about is the Sasha Fierce character. Many of you know, many of you have heard her do live open interviews about her saying in a very humble way back in the day when she still was talking and not a shell of herself, that she couldn't ever get on stage and be so bold and so vibrant and bodacious like Sasha Fierce was, because that wasn't her personality. So she would actually say and spell out while she was on stage, something would enter her and then would intercess who she was in the natural realm and bring in the spiritual realm forth this Sasha Fierce character that she has created and conceived, that is the Beyonce that we grew to love, the Beyonce that we rever, the Beyonce that so many of her fans worship. My loves, you have to understand, when someone is boldly telling you that there is something that comes over them to make them opposite of who they are in the natural realm, that is spiritual warfare. It is demonic. God doesn't ever have to have anything enter anybody that he gives a natural born talent to, because the talent is sustainable. The talent thrives. The talent shows itself in any industry, in any moment. You don't have to be overcome by anything coming into you to be in operating in your space of what God gave you. That is a red flag. The same way we pass through red flags in life and in relationships, we are deceived by a lot of these artists because we're missing the red flags. God wants you to understand it's okay if you don't understand what it is that I'm saying, because it's not knowledge that you had. But now that you have this knowledge, now that you've seen this podcast episode and you hear this information that I've spent months researching, you have to understand that now there is a duty for you to do your research. Test the spirit of the words that I'm saying and echoing, and you take it back to God and ask him to reveal to you what you need to see. Because from what I've said to you up until this point, this is all operating in a space of demonic spiritual warfare. The next part of the conversation that I want to bring to you is the movie Swarm. I don't know how many of you all have seen this movie. I watched the series where Chloe Bailey was one of Beyonce's artists, is one of Beyonce's artists. She was one of the artists in the film, or one of the people in the film that revered this character that was made up idolizing or personifying Beyonce. And it showed so many different things. It showed cult-like behavior happening in different episodes, where it would show people worshiping her to the point of death. It showed how people would want to, how this one young lady was killing people that spoke against Beyonce. It showed how rituals were being performed because of this character that was personifying Beyonce. And when I initially watched the film, I was still a Beyonce fan. And so in my mind, I'm thinking, this is sick. I wonder if Beyonce knew that these people were doing this film. How does she feel about this? Because this is so demonic. I had all these questions, because one thing about me, when I notice something isn't right and it's not passing through the spirit of God, I will test the fruit of it by asking questions like, what does this mean? But at the time, my naivete didn't allow me to research it further. So they were just mere surface level questions. So, okay, This series of Swarm came out, and so my gears are flowing, because I'm thinking this is all demonic and this doesn't seem normal. This came from somewhere. A lot of movies are the personification or metaphorically personifying something else that is transferring in the spiritual realm, but also happening in the physical. Like I said, 90% of what we go through in this life is spiritual. The 10% of it is physical. Please understand that what I'm saying is not anything light. I also can remember a time back when I was in college where God revealed to me that there was a lot of occultic and Illuminati practices as it relates to Beyonce. And I used to be a huge Alicia Keys fan. And I was just looking at, and I don't know why, I guess the spirit, the natural version of us that compare artists, I would always compare the two of them. And I always felt like Alicia Keys was a stronger artist vocally than Beyonce ever was. That was my own opinion at that time. And this was when she still was in the beginning of her solo career. And so I remember being in undergrad, and when I was in the midst of researching papers and writing all these things, I was too mentally distracted by those things in a positive way that I really didn't put much intention to what God had revealed to me even then in the early 2000s about the things that she was doing and what she was into. I swept it under the rug and I just kind of forgot about it. And that's how the enemy plays tricks too. He will sometimes use what God is trying to show you for good and make it evil. So he made me think that this was not something that was actually real. And all these years later, it's a full circle moment because it's exactly what God revealed to me years ago. This is over about 15 years ago that I first learned of this. And so the next part about it is, when you look at the movie Swarm, moving away from Swarm, let's look at some of her business ventures. Rihanna is an artist who has a personality that translates to her fans. She's a people person. She is friendly. She's loving. She's fun. All the things that these people think of her, it translates to her brand, Fenty and Savage X Fenty, her beauty care line and her lingerie line, workout line, all the things. And so the way her art transfers to her audience is because she actually spends time getting to know her audience. Beyonce has become such a shell of herself that there's not much that she does to coincide and talk to and kind of interact with the audience. So while everybody loves the art that she produces and they always want to rever her concerts and all these things, Beyonce the person has been completely erased from our minds. Where she used to do interviews and have very open discussions about herself, the light that she once possessed when she was a part of Destiny's Child, because she was raised in the church. Her mother did raise her that way, but there is a such thing as pivoting away from what you come up in once you start fraternizing with people in the world and of it. Jay-Z was her handler. He then became her groomer. Hence the reason why so many claims show allegedly that Beyonce is always being given drugs, being induced with a lot of alcohol, pills, all the things, because that's a way that Jay-Z keeps her sullen, keeps her as a shell of herself so that she doesn't have a voice. God revealed to me, thank you, Holy Spirit, that Beyonce is a lifeless soul now. The Beyonce that we once knew, a part of Destiny's Child that had a personality, that version of her is dead. When you wonder why so many people are making these jokes now that she's walking around with this bleach blonde hair saying, who is this white woman? It might sound funny. It might be even cute to make as a joke. This woman is showing up in the natural realm what she's been all these years in the spiritual realm. It was revealed to me that Beyonce is a witch and she practices witchcraft. And witchcraft is not what many people think, opening up a book of rituals and researching ways to possess people, know my loves. That's not always what witchcraft looks like. Witchcraft also comes in the form of manipulation, lying, misleading people, blaspheming God's name, misleading the flock, and showing up in a way that is not authentic to what God wants us to show up as vessels and followers of him. Witchcraft is not always the storybook definition. A lot of the times, it's just the manipulation tactics that the devil authors his people to pass through to mislead and bring souls to hell, bring them closer to him. So understand when I say that God revealed to me that she's a witch, she's showing up like that physically. It's why she doesn't look like herself anymore. It's why every time we see her in the public eye, it's weird the way she shows up. Her face doesn't look like the Beyonce that has the light. She looks lifeless. Her skin looks pale. You have to understand, these things that I'm saying are real. And if you choose to turn a blind eye and a deaf ear to what I'm saying, you don't have to worry about me judging you. You serve a God that sits high and looks low. And he watches everything that you idolize and everything that you put intention toward. And he is judging those things. When the rapture comes and judgment day comes, understand you have his judgment to worry about, not mine. So you don't have to take my word for it. Take the spirit, test it. Ask God if these things I'm saying are real and wait for him to confirm it. Because my loves, just make sure that you're mentally, emotionally, and spiritually prepared for the revelation that he sends to you once you ask him if what I'm saying is real. The next thing I'm going to go over to and talk about is a personal experience that I had when I went to the Philadelphia show. Now, I thought that obviously I've been to many concerts, I've been to many football games, all the things. The girl has had some fun. And so I thought that the seats that I was getting for the Philadelphia show were great seats, because if you were thinking about it in terms of a football game, it would have been great seats because a football game travels up and down the field. What I didn't realize that the Holy Spirit was leading me to do is to find seats that at a football game would have been good, but at the concert, they weren't that great. I didn't have a great view of this concert the way I wanted to. I also didn't get to the concert on time. The first half of the show was already done, where the portal, I'm going to break that down for you and explain to you too what that looks like in a minute here. But the portal that showed all the imagery when the concert first started, God didn't let me go into the concert until after that part was already over with. So to rewind it back, my sister, she also had tickets to go to the show. Now, I'm not going to get into explicit details. All I'm going to say is her phone was locked and she wasn't able to open her phone so that she can get access to her tickets. When that happened, my sister seriously loves Beyonce. She is a fan, probably more than I am as it relates to her solo career, part of her career. And she was so hurt. She was just traumatized because she couldn't get her phone open to get in the concert. And surprisingly, the people that work at Ticketmaster had closed it early. So my sister missed the entire concert. I felt so bad for her because in that moment, I was about to cry because I know how badly she wanted to see this concert. But like I said, sometimes we don't even willfully have idolatry over something. It's a subconscious thing. The enemy will play on the things that we like or that we have interest in, and he will turn it into an idol without our knowledge, especially, like I said, when you don't have wisdom and knowledge of what's in the Word, in the Bible. You can be misled and tricked by the enemy. And so when she didn't get into the concert, at that time, we didn't know why she didn't get in. I just felt bad for her. But later on, what God revealed to me is that he was protecting each of us from being exposed to the portal that opened up at that concert with all the imagery and all the spirits that were going to surface this audience, similar to the revelation that I saw with her levitation. This was actually happening in the physical realm. This portal that she showed of imagery, one of the ones that I can remember seeing on social media, is her legs being gapped wide open, it looking robotic, and there was an entryway to her vagina. And all of this imagery was pushing through her vagina, legs open, and there is scripture, and I can't remember the scripture. You can test this fruit by going and doing your own research for this specific scripture in the Bible where it was a blasphemy. That imagery was blasphemy to the Bible by saying these legs get wide open and accessing us a portal to her vagina. My love, she even had a song where she says she uses a page of the Bible to wipe her menses. If you don't know what she meant by that, she's basically using the pages of the Bible as a tampon. That is blasphemy. Whenever you say something like that about God's word, it's blasphemy. Do you understand why I'm telling you all? God wants you to turn away from your idolatry and your fandom of being a part of the beehive and being a fan of Beyonce altogether, because what she represents is demonic. She's not an artist authored by God, my loves. She's an artist authored by the devil. And I am being bold in these words that I'm saying to you because, like I said, they were real revelations that God gave me to give back to you. If you don't believe me, ask God and ask him to show you what you need to see. The next thing that I want to talk about is pivoting away from that whole concert fiasco and how God spared us from being sacrificed with spirits, entering us from going to that concert, just like astral world people losing their lives. A lot of things that happened to some people after this Renaissance tour were people having depression. Some people off the record, because they're never going to talk about things like that passing through about Queen B, committing suicide. These were very real things that we were being so distracted by this concert the whole summer and even into the fall because they weren't out there as stories that we can gain access to. When billionaires travel the face of this earth, they have the power to bury certain things so that no one finds out. But my loves, this is the year of exposure. God is not only exposing the Christian church and a lot of the pastors, such as T.D. Jakes that I once reported about, falling from grace. There's also a fall from grace from the artist as well. Everyone that is doing anything, even regular people, even those of you that are listening to my voice right now, watching this episode, if you're doing anything that God is displeased with and you pass through a warning and you pass through knowledge, coupled together and you choose to still turn a blind eye to changing your actions and turning away from your worldly engagements, God is going to judge you harshly. He is going to judge you in a way that he will turn away from you at some point. The young lady, Lala Jenkins, who is linked below, did an episode where she talked about some of these things I'm saying to you about Beyonce. And she said that she once too was a Beyonce fan, just like me. And she said God gave her the revelation that Beyonce was a witch in the spiritual realm and that she was demonic. And she said she was like, oh, my God, God, I just got to pray for her. And God said this boldly to Lala Jenkins. He said, don't pray for her. There are no more prayers that can save her soul. Once she faces my wrath and once her demise comes, there is no more mercy that is given to her soul. I've given her many chances. I've given her many opportunities. There's a prophet named Celestial on here as well on YouTube that you can go listen to. And I linked her below that talks about very bold prophecies that God gave her about Beyonce, where she said that she is going to face an untimely death because of her demonic engagement and the way she's misled so many of God's people through the imagery, through the songs, through the witchcraft, through the sacrifices, through all the things that she's done demonic-wise in this world physically. There is going to be an untimely death that she will face because of her actions. At some point, you have to understand God is a God of love and grace, true, but at some point his grace runs out. Once you gain knowledge coupled with wisdom, that is where God judges you differently than he does those that are ignorant. Ignorant means to not know. When you don't know, he looks at you like he does a baby and a fool. You're a baby in Christ in that way. But once you gain knowledge and wisdom, your judgment is different because now you know better. So the expectation is that you do better. And when you choose not to, you have to deal with his wrath. A lot of the pastors of today preach the prosperity gospel, but they don't preach the parts of the Bible that talk about God's wrath. What we're seeing now in Israel, that's real. Those are real accounts in the Bible. What we see happening to the celebrity culture right now of all of these celebrities being exposed, to Bill Cosby's, the Diddy's, the R. Kelly's, the now Jay-Z's, which I will do a later more in-depth episode about him individually, the Beyoncé's, they're all being judged and God's wrath is forming in the spiritual realm against these artists because God has given them grace so many times that they specifically chose not to turn away from their ways. And so God's grace has run out for them. The next thing that I'm going to do is I'm going right into scripture. The first scripture that I want to share with you is Ephesians 11 through 12. And it reads, according to eternal purpose, which he purposed in Christ Jesus, our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence by faith of him. The expectation is with the knowledge of this specific scripture that idolatry is not something that we would ever pass through. Because we understand when we rever and we honor Christ Jesus, our Lord, that our days not only will grow longer, but God will be pleased with our actions. He will be pleased with our movements in this earth because we're not mishandling his words. We're not mishandling the works of Jesus, but we're honoring and upholding them. We're uplifting and edifying. We're bringing people closer to him, not away from him. That scripture is how he feels about the people that do decide to handle his works and his words with the righteousness and not ever be tempted by the enemy. The next scripture, 1 John 5, verse 21. Little children, keep yourselves from idols. My loves, I spent this entire episode talking to you about what idolatry looks like. You have got to turn away from your worldly idols because if you don't, God is going to make pay. And we all know, and for those of you that don't, the repayment of God's wrath when you don't honor him and rever and worship him is hell. You will go straight to hell when you put idolatries over anything above God. The last scripture that I'm going to share with you is the one God placed in my spirit before, when I was right before this episode preparing, about false gods and idolatry for them. Exodus 22:20 says, whoever sacrifices to any other god other than Lord must be destroyed. The reason why I gave you a very bold prophecy that Celestial shared and that God revealed directly to me, Lala Jenkins, and whoever else has shared, and I have given you their footage down below that you can go look at for yourself, is because Beyonce has done exactly what Exodus 22:20 says not to do. She has sold her soul to the devil for fame and fortune, her billionaire empire that she's created, the lies, the back she stepped on, the sacrifices, the witchcraft, the allowing Jay-Z to be her handler, pivoting away from what her mother raised her to be as a Christian, turning over to the dark side and the demonic realm. That is what she passes through now. So when I tell you that God said her untimely demise will be his wrath of death in the worst way possible, this is not me wishing death on someone's life. This is a revelation that was sent by God, and I'm just reporting it as a messenger. Don't shoot me or chastise or come for me as a messenger without first testing the fruit of the spirit of what I'm saying and taking it back to God and asking him to give you revelation on the things that I shared in this episode. This is one of the most difficult episodes that I've ever had to present. The information was not easy to gather. Like I said, I've been practicing, I've been studying, I've been researching, and I've been connecting in covenant with God for over 3 months about all of this. It is not easy to present these things when you once were a fan of someone. And it is even more disheartening to my spirit that I have to say something like this about someone dying, because I don't wish death on anybody's life. And I wouldn't want it to be done to me, even though it has. God watches. He sees everything that we don't. He knows everything that we do. And even when we think we're hiding things from him, you can hide things from man, but you can never run and hide things from God. My loves, this message is for everyone that worships or revers the Carter family, especially per this episode, Beyonce Knowles. You have to understand that this is a warning message. If you choose to do with it what you will, you do the lesser of the two, that will be your own cross to carry from God. I am just the messenger. This episode has ended. I thank you for your time today. I will talk to you guys in 2 weeks with Kyron. He will be coming back. I hope this message resonated where it needed to, and I hope you do take it very seriously, because it was not a light warning. It was a very heavy warning that was placed in my spirit. I will talk to you guys the next time. I'm out.